Welcome everyone to the first afternoon session. Our first speaker will be Roman Bartak, and he will be presenting a paper from the journal presentation prep.
Yeah, okay, thank you for the introduction. So my name is Roman Bartak, and this is a joint work with my student, Jindrich Vodrazka. I was asked what this very long title actually means. So rather than explaining the title, let me explain you the motivation behind this work. So we have the ultimate goal to recognize what's the most critical component of the planning process. I mean, when you start with the problem and you finish with the solution, what's the most important part that contributes to efficiency of planning? And actually, I have a small goal for this presentation, which in some sense reveals the conclusion of this talk. And the goal is to somehow convince you that planning does not start with the PDDL model. There is something that you need to do before developing the model. And maybe that's even more important for efficiency of the planning. So in this study, we used a system called PyCAT, which is a logic programming system, and we use it to encode planning problems because it has a huge flexibility in encoding various planning, and not only planning, but also knowledge representation techniques. So in PyCAT, we still separate domain model from the solver. You need to describe state transition. So now I'm talking about, in some sense, classical planning. And you describe them using what we call action rules. These are rules that looks like classical prolog rules, if you know prolog programming language. So PyCAT is prolog based. So to sketch the structure of the rule, this is like the header. So you want to say, okay, I want some action that goes from some state to some new state that I will calculate, and I will provide you the action and cost of doing it. Before we can apply the action, we can verify the precondition. So it could be any program that somehow checks if the state is fine for that action. We can also include some simple control knowledge in this part, checking if that action is reasonable for that state. I will give example in a minute. And if this is satisfied, then we can generate a next state. So the next state is actually generated by the program, and also we calculate the cost, and we can also verify whether the distance to the goal is still okay if you are doing an optimization problem. And basically, the domain model is a collection of these rules that are explored in a depth-first search sense. I will describe later how the search or how the planning is done. Obviously, you need to finish the search sometimes. So we need to specify the goal condition, which is also very easy. We have a rule like this one that gets a state, and it does some verification whether the state is the final one. And then the search stops. So to give some very specific example, I took a very simple domain, no mystery, perhaps you know it. We have a graph with one truck that is moving between the nodes, and the goal is to move packages from one location to another location. That's it. So I will show you how we can represent some actions in this model to justify that the model is not that far, let's say, from PDDL. So the state can be represented as any data structure that you can use. So we can use the factored representation, classical one in PDDL, a vector of values of some state variables. So this is how it looks. So this is a description of a executable relay action. So this is a cut and copy from the program of the load action. So the state is represented as a vector where we have the fuel variable because it's so specific, it's just one. Then we have a vector of atoms called at locations of objects, and then we have the in predicate. So this is the typical model in PDDL, at locations and in locations. And the verification of the precondition for the action is done by this simple program. So this is like a typing. So we take the name of the truck. By the member, we find the location of the truck among the at predicates. Then we find some another object C among the at predicates that should be different from truck, so it will be a container. And if this is true, it means that we have a truck and container at the same location, and we can load the container to the truck. So we have the action loading container to truck at the location, the cost is one, and we generate the next state, which is the structure with the same style. So this is a classical, I would say, the PDDL style of describing states, but because the states can be any data structures, we can make the states, say, more advanced, and we can include more information in the state. I'll be talking about so-called structured representation of the state, where we can, for example, break object symmetries. So rather than giving names to objects, because we need it for the predicates, we can identify each object just using properties of that object. For example, in this case, containers are going from some location to another location, and the important information about container are just the locations. That's it. So we can encode this in the state representation. So it looks somehow similar, but there are some significant differences. Now we have a specific location of the truck. We have the fuel capacity for the truck, and then we have the list of loaded cargo items in that truck, which is basically a list of destination of cargos that are loaded, and we have also a list of waiting cargos. So we can see that there is no name of the cargo item, it's just the initial location and the destination. And in this simple way, we can break many symmetries in states. And if you will see, it has a dramatic effect on the efficiency. And the rest is basically the same. Moreover, I mentioned that we can specify some form of control knowledge. Okay, so let me show some simple control knowledge that can be described. Actually, it can be even described in PDDL. So for example, for the load action, there is a simple control knowledge which says that if there is some cargo at a location that does not belong to that location and should be moved somewhere else, then this cargo should be loaded, unless there is something to be unloaded first. Okay, so this can be specified in this language using this program. So we have the goal, we verify that there is no loaded item, so there is no item, no cargo item which is in the track, and that belongs to the location where the track is right now. So there is nothing to unload. Then we look for some cargo item that is at the same location as the track, it's not the track, and this cargo item does not belong to that location, so it should be moved somewhere. This is a trivial common sense knowledge, and we can express this type of common sense knowledge there, and again, as you will see, it will dramatically change efficiency of the planner. About the planner itself, it's actually a very simple planner. The planner, as I said, is basically depth first search. You can describe the planner at the same language, so this is the code of the planner. So that's it, planner. So we get a state as the input, and we generate a plan with a given cost. So what the planner does is it checks if the state is the final one. If yes, we are done, plan is empty, cost is zero. Otherwise, we non-deterministically select some action which is applicable to that state, next state, and we continue from that state. That's it, okay? And there was this magic word tabling that I mentioned here, which is basically memorizing states. So it means that if you find a plan going from S to the goal, you remember that plan, so the next time when you visit that state, you don't need to look for that plan. Actually, it's slightly more advanced. It can do even optimization. So if you find a plan going to the goal, and if there is an alternative version to find a plan which is better, then the system looks for it, so it can do optimizations there. The optimization is done using very simple techniques. This is the domain model there. We use iterative deepening, and we use branch and bound. So just two quite simple search techniques. Okay, so now about the real results of this paper. So I will show you many graphs now, but to make it less boring, I will have some provocative conclusions from these graphs. So we did many experiments using IPC domains. We compare the planner with the existing planners, domain dependent, domain independent, and we also look on the effect of using factors, structured representation, iterative deepening, branch and bound, using control knowledge, and so on. So these are the results. So first, comparison with the best according to last IPC optimal planner. Number of solved problems. Yeah, so as you expected. And you may say, okay, Roman, this is not fair. You are comparing with a domain independent planner But I say, yes, but why you do not encode the same information as we encode in the PDDL? You can do it, right? And you can improve your planner exactly in the same way as we did it. So it would be interesting to see if we can improve efficiency of planners by including this very simple common sense knowledge in these planners. So somehow the conclusion is that if we include some very simple common sense knowledge, you don't need to know how to find the plan, but simple rules, you can beat the best planners so far. Well, that's that outcome, right? Okay, so you say, okay, this is domain independent. So let's compare with domain dependent planners, okay? There are like the TL plan, TL planner, shop too. So we did a comparison. Obviously, all these planners can find solutions in a fraction of time. So what we did compare was the quality of plan. Using the classical quality rules, so the larger number means better quality. We use like a runtime 5 minutes and what this table says is basically this Piket planner is comparable with other planners. What's even more interesting is to describe how complicated it is to design models for these planners. It's hard to say how to objectively describe how hard is it to do domain modeling. So what we did is we just take the model and we counted the number of lines in the model. Very simple rule, okay? So these are the number of lines in the models. So we can see PDDL very short because there is no extra information. If you look at TL plan and SHOP2, well, the models are much, much larger, especially in TL plan where you need to express control knowledge. Piket, well, it's slightly larger than the PDDL, much, much smaller than expressing HTNs or control knowledge. Okay? So this somehow justifies that we use just very simple additional information there. Okay. About the other results, so it means that you don't need to know completely how to solve your problem. It's enough to encode some simple common sense knowledge to improve efficiency of the planner. So I will now try to be very speed, very, very fast. So if you want to compare what's the difference between factored and structured representation. This is a graph showing the number of solved problems in a given time. So this is for the factored representation without any heuristics, without any control knowledge. If we just include structured representation, so we just change the model, meaning in this case breaking object symmetries, we can improve the efficiency quite significantly. And if we include both of them, it's even better, including control knowledge and heuristics. So this is for iterative depending. For branch and bound, the graph is very similar. So the conclusion is that if we represent the state in a structured way rather than as a vector of values, this is already beneficial for efficiency of planning. Okay, so let's go down. So we have heuristics versus control knowledge. So this is an iterative deepening factored representation. Again, runtime, number of solved problems. Pure factored representation, if we include heuristics, it's better. If we include only control knowledge, no heuristics, you can see it's much, much better. And if we include both of them, so they are beneficial, it's even better. Okay? And we can see the same pattern if we use, for example, the branch and bound procedure, but then the effect of heuristics is much smaller, as you will see in a minute. If we do the same for the structured representation, heuristics are quite beneficial, but still control knowledge is even more important without heuristics. And the same is for branch and bound. Okay? So what's the conclusion? The conclusion is that somehow heuristics are more important for iterative deepening than for the branch and bound search procedure. But control knowledge is even more important than heuristics. So even if you use, I would say, perfect heuristics, still control knowledge leads to better results. Okay? So let's now look somehow in a different search technique. So I mentioned that we use iterative deepening and branch and bound. This graph shows a comparison of these two techniques. Again, time, number of solved problems. This is branch and bound for solving problems optimally. This is iterative deepening. So somehow it says iterative deepening is better for optimization than branch and bound. But if you just look for any plan, meaning you run the branch and bound just the first iteration, you can solve much more problems. Okay, but these are not solved optimally. These are suboptimal solutions. So again, for optimization, iterative deepening sounds like a good option for the search procedure. Good, so if you look inside iterative deepening, how is the behavior of the planner? It's quite hard to describe it for all the problems together. So this is a graph showing how the planner, you know, in iterative deepening, we are extending the length of the plan until we find the plan, and then it's optimal one regarding the cost or length. So this shows how we are getting closer to the solution, which was like 45. And this is the runtime in logarithmic scale. So if we do not use any extra information, we actually are not able to find the solution. If we use the heuristics, you can see this somehow describes how the heuristic is good. So at some level it says, okay, you can go very fast because there is no solution. But when we are becoming closer to the goal, it's more complicated for heuristics to help. And control knowledge is helping a lot at the end. If we combine both, then it's even better. So this was one example. If you have a perfect heuristic, or almost perfect heuristic, which was in the normal history where we can almost perfectly calculate how far is it to the goal, you can see the heuristic is very good. It can tell you, okay, don't try any plans which is shorter than 30 steps because there is no solution. But at the end, it's not helping a lot, and the control knowledge is actually slightly better at the end. Surprising result, because the heuristic was very good there. For the branch and bound, so heuristics help at the beginning of iterative deepening, but not that much at the later stages. In branch and bound, the situation is slightly different. In branch and bound, we find some solution, and we are going down. Okay, so we are making it closer to the solution. So this graph shows, this is the ratio between the solution and the optimal solution. So one means we got the optimum. If it's below one, it's a longer plan. And we can see that if we use heuristics, they are somehow helping more at the end, less at the beginning, which is not surprising because the bound at the beginning is, there is no bound, so the heuristic cannot tell you, don't go there, it's too far, okay? And this is a similar graph for, again, when we have a very good heuristic. So it basically, the conclusion is that the heuristics for branch and bound are more beneficial at the end of search than at the beginning. Okay, so to conclude, what's the take-home message from all these graphs? So I already revealed it at the beginning. So I believe somehow that a proper domain model and using control knowledge is more efficient for planning than any advanced heuristics and search techniques, which is the bad message for the heuristics track, but this is somehow the result of these experiments. And if you want to look which control knowledge we used, you can go to the PyCat web page. You will find all the models, and you will see that really we use somehow naive control knowledge, like don't unload something that you just loaded. Very simple information. Okay. So thank you for your attention. No, SHOP2 is HDN. So SHOP2 is doing the composition of tasks. We are doing the same thing as, let's say, classical STRIPS planners. So we are doing sequential planning without any hierarchical structure. So it's a different approach. We are much closer to TALPLAN and TL planner, which are sequential planners but with extra control knowledge.
So as you said, you can encode a lot of this, at least the control knowledge, maybe not all of the structured representation, but some in TDDL as well. So what does it look like if you do that and run the advanced planners on that?
Well, we did not encode the structured representation. We tried some of the control knowledge. And it helps some planners. It destroys some other planners, yeah. Probably because we destroy the view, the way how they use the heuristic by adding extra information in the model. But the help was not that significant as we observe it in this system. So it helped, but not that much for classical planners.
Yeah,
while they are setting up. Maybe simple question. So this tabling to me looks like a little bit like a closed list in a classical best first
search. It's very closed. It's not exactly, because you can, for example, table state with variables and so on. So you can actually table more states in a single data structure. But it's very close to the closed list in classical search. But it's also including some optimization. So it's not exactly. I mean, you remember the state and the plan, not just the state. And if there are alternative plans, you can explore them even if it's closed in some sense. So it's not the same. I mean, closed means you explored all the alternatives. Tabled means you found a single plan from it. So you are not trying to find others.
Maybe
so there is some difference, yeah.
So thank the speaker again.